Hello, I'm occasionally employed actor Josh Carson. I'm holding for your applause. I am continuing. And now I am humbly cutting it off before it gets embarrassing. Boy, what a nutty little theatrical experience this is, right? I mean, at the very least, tonight's production is giving your streaming service of choice a chance to catch its breath. Because if you're anything like me, you've used these last 2 months of isolation to catch up on every piece of television that was ever made. Now, as others seek out content in this time and they're catching up on classic TV shows that they may have missed around the first time, I've noticed a trend where they don't initially like the show. And then the advice that's most commonly given is, you know what? Skip the first season. It starts getting good after that. I frequently hear that about The Office, Parks and Rec, The Simpsons, Community, Always Sunny. These are all huge comedy classics in their own right. And everybody says, yeah, the first season is a little rough. Now, anyone that knows anything that goes into television production knows that it takes years of blood, sweat, and tears just to get that one single first episode on the air, only for years later all of that hard work to be reduced to, yeah, that first season is bullshit, just skip to the second season. Now, as cruel as it sounds, it is also kind of true. Some of those early seasons are bad, but even those worst early episodes, you still see a flash of the brilliance that is yet to come. It makes one grateful that the early season of your life is not readily available, so it's not to tarnish that sweet, sweet crystal meth that is nostalgia. As if on cue, my friend of 25 years called me and said he recently unearthed a film we made in ninth grade English class, and he wanted to know if I wanted to see it. Well, absolutely I do. And do you want to see it as well? Well, you're trapped. Your options are limited. Are you going to sit there and watch what is essentially my home movies? Yes, you are. It was spring, 1995. Miss Donnelly's English class was just finishing the unit on Romeo and Juliet. As a reward, the class was treated to the 1968 Franco Zeffirelli adaptation of that story. It's 2 hours and 20 minutes, 40 of them are boring, and the rest of them are the guy that plays Romeo's ass. After it was done, I said to my friends, you know what, we could do better than that. And they said, Josh, there's already a Romeo and Juliet movie. Why would we need another one? And I said, get this. What if, and stay with me here, what if we set a Shakespearean story in modern times? Yes. After the spontaneous parade celebrating my originality, we got to work. I wrote a full script and I secured a filming location, my aunt and uncle's house just down the street, so chosen because it was so close to the high school, it was large, and they had a trampoline. Over the next 5 days, we shot our vision of what Romeo and Juliet would have looked like in the 90s. It was temporarily titled Romeo and Juliet in the 90s. That title unfortunately stuck. Now what you're about to see is 25-year-old VHS footage, 10 of which were spent in an attic in Texas. Now, some of the sound has been warped, and some of the acting has also deteriorated over time. Now, the first update to our story is to make it a struggle of class warfare. It's a forbidden love story of an uptown girl living in her uptown world, falling for a backstreet guy.
Sorry, people. Who are filthy rich. And then, of course, right across the street from them, live the Montagues with their son, Romeo.
Yeah, I'm gonna need the beer I brought from home to get through the rest of this. Also, it's a good thing I told you it was set in the 90s, because there's no way you would be able to tell with that outfit. Alright, now the action ramps up when Romeo and his friends try to sneak their way into a party thrown at the Capulet Mansion, the only way they know how, by reenacting a mildly amusing Bud Light commercial of the era.
What if they find out you're a Montague? Well, then they're gonna get really ticked off! Rush out, let's go! Right. Cool? Huh?
Excuse me. Invitation for you?
Oh, ma'am, excuse me. Where are they going with all this Bud Light?
The Capulet Party.
Well, then I am here for the Capulet Party.
You're here for the Capulet Party.
Yes, I am.
We just sweet.
Thank you.
Now, in addition to writing and acting, I was also directing. And one might say it's difficult to direct a scene when you are appearing within it. But if you look closely, I managed to find a way.
Hey, fabulous, how you doing? Oh, yes.
Hey, 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 how are you?
How are you doing?
You're looking good.
Looking good. You guys, I told you this was going to be...
Thankfully, I have outgrown that particular directing style.
He has not.
Real professional, Robinson. It's here that Romeo first lays eyes on the fair Juliet, and rather than use that iconic love theme from the Zeffirelli film, we instead use New Age Girl by everybody's favorite 90s band, Dead Eye Dick. The footage, unfortunately, did not survive the transfer. Even more unfortunately, the following footage did.
Romeo, I'll think straight here, man. She Capulet, you Montague, that means big trouble.
You guys, I don't care. Look at her.
She's got your attention somehow.
The death?
The death.
We did the entire song, and it instantly made her fall in love with me because I wrote it. And now, 14 minutes into a movie called Romeo and Juliet, Juliet has her first line of dialogue. It was a rather bold choice to do a movie called Romeo and Juliet and have Juliet barely appear in it, but that was for a very good reason. We only had her available for 2 of the shooting days, and she did not want to do it.
No. Alrighty then.
Now, some of that scene was damaged, but there was a romantic sweet dancing and then a child chasing a balloon. Why? Because my aunt said that if we were going to film at her house, we had to put her kids in it. So we wrote a part for my cousin Nick, a small boy chasing a red balloon, based on the 1956 Oscar-winning French film, The Red Balloon. Why? Because I'm a classy bitch. I just don't reenact beer commercials. Next came the famous balcony scene, a staple in the Romeo and Juliet legend. Now, we did not have a balcony, but we did have a substitute that was not at all obvious. Now, I'd like you to pay attention to 2 things in the following scene. The scintillating dialogue, written by a 15-year-old boy, knowingly describing himself, and the actress's commitment to that dialogue.
Finally, I have to find a cute enough guy who won't even consider dating me because he's my enemy. I've never felt this way about a guy before. It's like my dream man or something. He's good looking, funny, sweet, great dancer, and he's Cuban, but he's a Montague, a Montague. Why do bad things have to happen to great looking people sometimes?
Yada yada yada, we fall in love, I fall off the deck.
The boy she loves is the boy that makes her kizzy and faint. You heard her, people. That boy is me.
Yeah!
Now, that last bit might seem strange, and not just because the balloon boy made an appearance again, but no, I was reciting the line as Hugo F. Peabody from the play Bye Bye Birdie, which I was cast in at the time. That musical was happening that weekend. So, I made a plug for my own work within the movie I was forcing the class to watch. Oh, only a young rapscallion can get away with such shameless tomfoolery. Now I have lost my place. Hold on, I found it. Yes. All right. The 2 teenagers get married, and the lost dialogue, we can't get married, but we're teenagers, and Romeo's response, yeah, but my church is really bad, is unfortunately lost to time. Now, since we did not have a Juliet for a majority of the shoot, and we were teenage boys, we spent a majority of our time milking the battle scenes. Now, we spent 3 whole days on this fight. First, Tybalt fights Mercutio. Still there. The only criticism of this film is that it follows the story of Romeo and Juliet pretty closely, and there's nothing to discern it from that past era and the 90s. And to that I say, excuse me, we added gun violence and seamless transition. Seriously, I dare you to find where day one ends and day two begins.
You guys, you guys, this is totally wrong. It's love thy neighbor, not hate thy neighbor. Go on, get up, buddy.
He hurts me.
Okay, you're on your own, Mercutio. Oh. No, buddy, Mercutio. Pal, oh my God, I can't believe this happened. Does it hurt? Oh, shit. I'm so sorry. I didn't know it was there. Oh. It was so weird. My God, I am such a fool. Oh my God,
take my life.
Hey, get out of here.
And then, it's time for the main event.
That's great. Stars, Chris, and Eric. Wait, birds, snakes, and airplanes. Lenny Bruce, you're not afraid. I have all promise of yourself, turn world to the dumb.
Now we're pretty much just fucking around. There might be some repressed stuff going on here. Alright, that bit's just still funny. Anyhow, I beat him to death with a baseball bat. Here's the thing about this movie. It's 1 hour and 15 minutes long, including the blooper reel. Now, you all know the story. The drama ramps up considerably and Romeo seeks help from his drunken pastor friend who lives in a bathtub.
Tybalt, the guy with the weird hair, I killed him.
Juliet and I continue to have unquestionable chemistry.
No. I gotta go, Juliet.
Bye. No. I play a dual role as Juliet's rival love interest, setting up a love triangle with myself, which is not at all indicative of self-sabotage in future relationships. We're not afraid to tackle hot-button issues.
I'll kill myself!
No!
Juliet fakes her own death by drinking a bottle of nail polish remover.
You were marrying this man on Thursday.
Yes, you've been marrying on Thursday. That's what you're gonna do. That's the way to tell him that yo. Oh, this must be some.
Instead of writing the scene, we just decided to improv our way through it.
Dead?
She's dead, that's what I said. She's dead.
Oh boy, it's my favorite.
Oh, I hope she didn't have that pretty little head. She's dead.
I can't believe it, Fred.
I'm not dead.
And it's finally time for the tragic finale. Upon hearing of Juliet's death, Romeo gets a bottle of poison from Dr. Kevorkian, whom I was only aware of because I watched late-night comedy in the 90s.
Join her.
Goodbye. I'm so glad you're here. Sorry, I caught you before you did something stupid.
What?
She's alive. It was my master plan.
Wait, she's alive?
Yeah.
She's
alive. You're
all... Oh,
my God.
We're all alive.
Oh, my God. I thought you were being dead, and drank poison. Pastor. Poison.
Oh! Have another one, you drunk!
Poison.
stars will be all...
Shut up, shut up!
I shouldn't have went with you, BF!
Balloon!
I should have been accident!
Balloon! Balloon!
Kid! Kid! I'm dying! Would you shut up with the stupid balloon or are you shut up with it, too?
Come on, where is it? Oh, no, it is. Now go away, I'm gonna die!
And you fuck my balloon.
Yeah, that's right.
I hate you.
No!
Oh, that's not the balloon, Doctor!
That kick was not planned.
The balloon is dead. The poison is in me. I'm gonna die now.
Go through!
Goodbye, Master.
Come on!
My death scene lasts over 10 minutes.
Oh, man. What an awful plan.
Oh, let's see.
Hey! It ain't poison.
What the heck are you talking about?
It's bad.
It ain't too poison.
What's this now? Romeo was not poisoned? The fake death gambit worked out? Yes! In my original ending, Romeo and Juliet were tabloid stars and used their fame to fool the press into thinking that they had died tragically, thus to escape into obscurity and live happily ever after. What a meta twist! And meta wasn't even invented yet. However, due to time constraints and Juliet's utter refusal to film just one more scene, we had to write a new ending on the spot.
Romeo Montague!
Uh-oh.
This is the police! Come out with your hands up!
The thing I did a little bit ago.
It wasn't me! It was the one-armed man!
That's the oldest trick in the book!
Reference comedy!
Eyes to come out. Then we'll open fire!
Oh, God!
What did they remind?
No.
Romeo and Juliet are cut down in a hail of gunfire, fade to black, the end. What's the larger lesson there? I don't know, but it's an ending. You may wonder what grade we received on this assignment. Well, we didn't, because it was never really an assignment. We just did it on our own and then handed it in. The guy that played Tybalt wasn't even in our English class. We just handed it to our English teacher and said, here's the project. She said, what project? We said, the passion project. And then she said, wait, I have to just go home and watch this? And again, an hour and 15 minutes long. Teachers do not get paid enough. Now, this is a quintessential season one episode. Lots of heart, lots of work, and it's not very good. Although Baz Luhrmann did do his version of Romeo and Juliet in the 90s. 2 years later. I'm not saying he ripped us off, but the timeline supports that theory. Now, even though it is rough, I go back to my original question. Is there a spark there? A spark that is going to lead to a much more larger creative fire? Just last year, Barb, the surly technician at the Bryant Lake Bowl, was talking about the enduring legacy of a Christmas show that I don't recall the title of right now. And she mentioned the appeal and fun that the audience has is we're just a bunch of kids playing in our backyard and charging people money to watch it. And if that is not the perfect description of my comedic style, I don't know what is. This was my first backyard, and I'm still playing in it. Oh, and even though Romeo and Juliet did meet a grim fate in this movie, if you pay close attention to the very end, you'll notice a glimmer of hope that things might be okay. Sequel!